actually, in terms of higher ed news processing, is the best app out there. I mean, you can get what I want. And they got bought by Pulse, I think.
Right.
It's too low.
Already 6 minutes in. Oh, the audio people aren't here. Oh, there. People have already gone to the beach.
It's all they can do,
yeah. Trouble with doing the afternoon sessions. Yeah, right, especially, yeah.
Good afternoon. I'm Manoj Chaliver from Longwood Universities, and I direct the Institute for Teaching Through Technology and Innovative Practices. So at the Institute, we've been using open education resources from 2005. So I'm really excited about OpenVA every year, last year and this year, and I hope that we'll be able to have some fruits out of this conference. But this panel, it's all about open pedagogy. And we have four panelists, and each one may address anywhere from 10 to 15 minutes, depending on the time that it takes for them to present. And then we will have questions at the end, not at the end of each presentation. First, we have Jeff McClurkin. He's a professor of history and American studies and special assistant to the provost for teaching technology and innovation at the University of Mary Washington. His PhD in American history is from Johns Hopkins University, and Dr. McClurkin's research areas include the history of Civil War, veterans, families, the Pinkertons, mental institution, the 19th century American South, and the digital humanities. His book, Take Care of the Living, Reconstructing the Confederate Veteran Family in Virginia, was published by the University of Virginia Press in 2009. He was the 2014 Teaching with Technology winner of the Virginia State Council of Higher Education's Outstanding Faculty Award. Jeff.
That's a lot of buildup, especially considering I'm the first person to have to talk after lunch. So we'll see what we can do. I also, half thought about just throwing away what I was going to talk about because the conversation we had in the last session was so interesting. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to stay on task, and I'm going to set a timer so I stay on time. What I want to talk about today in the context of open pedagogy is frankly about the many undergraduate classes that I teach in which the classes themselves and the student projects are outward facing. They are public, and we do that through a variety of ways. We use Twitter, WordPress, wikis, Rumeka. We use UMW blogs and Domain of One's Own, as Ryan and Martha talked about in the last session. Most of these classes are showcased at McClurkin.org, and I've also got, if you just go to the selected presentations, the first tab on that is OpenVA 2014, and that will include all the links that I'm going to talk about now. Open pedagogy plays out for me in two ways, and it's not just for me. I think this is something that we can see among many of my colleagues at Mary Washington. First of all, Class syllabi and resources, this seems obvious, but I think it's important. Class syllabi and resources are available via UMW blogs or our own WordPress sites or on Domain of One's Own sites. They're public. They are public facing, and they are available for people to see. And the second way that it plays out in our classes is that we have students write, design, and create for a public audience, right? That they are not just creating for us. They're creating for a public audience. And they're really, I don't know that I need to spend too much time justifying teaching in the open at a conference on OpenVA, but let me just say, I think the notion of public audience is particularly key. I think there are benefits to students for them to write for an audience that isn't me. It's important for them to learn from each other. I'm particularly interested in opening up that traditional closed system of undergraduate knowledge production by which a student product goes only to the instructor, right? So I give an assignment, student does the assignment, I grade the assignment, student agonizes and pores over my comments, staying up late into the night wondering what I meant by them. If that's some other way in reality, don't disabuse me of that notion. We need to try to transcend that. We need to get out of that. We need to break out. There's a lot of productive knowledge being created by our students that really, frankly, is being wasted. And I think there are also, on the practical side, benefits for the school, right? It gives us a chance to demonstrate the life of the mind. There is a notion of transparency here of what it is that we do in the so-called ivory tower. And as state institutions, we have, I think, a particular duty to reveal to people in the state and beyond what it is that we do and what it is that's happening. So how does that work out? Well, as I said, so I have the syllabi and assignments for all the classes. Available here, and you can take a look at them. We do lots of different things. The projects range from posting on a discussion wiki that we've created about the readings, to research blogging, to annotating primary sources. So this is a document from Martha Ballard, if you're familiar with The Midwife's Tale. I have students actually go to these online primary sources and, using a tool called a hypothesis, actually annotate those existing sites, right, with commentary, right, based in the research that we've done in class. So it's not just about accessing available online sources, it's actually about annotating those online sources and adding to them and creating to. And these are public comments that anyone who has the hypothesis tool can go and take a look at, right? We also build projects, right? So this is an online museum that the students have created about history of American technology on a variety of different topics, right? And you can check those out. They also have built digital repositories of sources that others can use, whether it's more detail about all of the state historical markers in the Fredericksburg, Stafford, and Spotsylvania area, right? So I had this very sort of transformative moment when some of the students came to me, and these markers, many of which were put up in the 1920s and 1930s, and they said, "Dr. McClurkin, some of these are wrong." Right? Exactly, right? And so then they developed a whole section of the site where they talk about how the markers were constructed and how they are a product of the time in which they were made. And they created a timeline that actually includes not just when the events that are portrayed in those markers happened, but when the markers themselves were created, right? And so that's a resource, and actually still, I haven't checked it lately, but for a long time, if you search on Google, right, for Virginia historical markers or Fredericksburg historical markers, this site is often in the top 10 of results, right? It gets tens of thousands of hits a year. That's a public resource those students created for students over the course of a semester. Oh, it's number one. All right. Great. Thanks, Ryan. And then other sources, right? So the James Monroe Museum is affiliated with the University of Mary Washington. And for reasons that still are unclear, a previous curator of the museum collected 114 original political cartoons that have absolutely nothing to do with James Monroe. And so they can't show them in the museum. They have a very tiny museum. There's no reason to use them. And so four students in the class digitized those political cartoons. They made them available. They tagged them. They researched about each of the individual. In some cases, these are incredibly obscure topics. They're about only relevant to small towns in Nebraska, right? But that process of making those things available, all right? And then James Farmer taught at the University of Mary Washington for a number of years, the civil rights leader. I had four students who spent the semester digitizing 13 of his lectures that were still around from the 1980s that were available only in Betamax form in our special collections. Digitized them, transcribed them, and made all those things publicly available. In other cases, it's just simply a matter of that the open part of the process is that we build the syllabus together with the students, right? That we have an outline, and then we work with the students to say, well, what are the important things on this topic, and what topics do they want to focus on within these larger trends, and what readings are the best way to explore each of these topics. In other times, open pedagogy for me includes bringing in students from 9 different public liberal arts institutions across the country to collaborate virtually, right? So bring together virtually in a virtual space, a history of college campuses during the Great War and the influenza epidemic, right? So those are the states from which we have projects, and so we had students at each of those schools in Utah and in Missouri, right, all across the country, creating along the same lines a history of what was happening on their campuses during the Great War, what was happening in the towns, publishing all kinds of primary sources that had never been available before. So again, complementing the larger historiography in some pretty important ways. The historiography of the Great War really doesn't focus very much on what was happening on the home front. It's very much focused on what's happening abroad. And this was a chance to see this in a new perspective. So all of these are different ways that we've approached open pedagogy and outward-facing pedagogy. There's clearly an impact of this, right? There's an impact for faculty work and teaching and learning, so my digital identity is pretty tied up with these sites as well. Having syllabi outside of closed LMSs, whether it's Blackboard or Canvas, means that faculty searching for assignments or reading ideas or just trying to conceptualize a topic or an assignment are being influenced by my teaching and by the teaching of my colleagues who are also making those things available. But less selfishly about, oh, great, everybody knows who we are, this is what we should be doing. Right, as teachers, we shouldn't be recreating the wheel. We should be sharing information about our classes, not hiding them where no one but our students can see them. Publicly available syllabi and demonstrated work gets out of the classroom, and it is these are open educational resources as well. But I do want to echo something that Anina was alluding to earlier. Colleges and universities need to recognize and reward open pedagogy and OER creation in tenure and promotion discussions. They have to do it, because if they don't, if you want faculty to do this, you need to get, it's a simple cost-benefit analysis. I'm not an economist, but I understand that much about economics. You have to give them a reason to do it. And if you put it into what it is that they do, if you give them credit for what they do, not necessarily that you even pay them for it, but if you give them credit for what they do, they will value it more and they will invest their time in that. But it also matters for our students, right? I think there are plenty of success stories we can point to, individual success stories we can point to from Mary Washington about how open-facing work is particularly helpful. Caitlin Murphy was a student of ours who did a lot of work in history and in digital media. She was one of the people who worked on the James Farmer project. She now works for PBS as a video editor editing historical documentaries, right? So a clear line, and when she applied for the job, she submitted her portfolio with her digital work, and what they said to her when she came in for the interview was that part of the reason she had gotten that interview was because they had looked at her work and they had seen what she was capable of and they knew she was capable of it, and so they chose her to come in because of that. Candace Rowland, in much the same way, now works for the Virginia Historical Society, and her Domain of One's Own project included a digital resume and a digital portfolio of her work, and again, that outward-facing work, things that they could point to, had real consequences. I haven't heard a whole lot of talk today about concerns about students talking and publishing their work online and some of the things that they may leave them open to. I'd like to talk about that some in question and answer. I don't have a whole lot of time left here, but I think if that's something people are concerned about, don't be silent about that. That's a conversation we should have in the open, because there are certainly ways we can address that. What I've found is that students, for the most part, if you explain what you're doing to them in advance and you explain why you're doing it to them, that they will be much more, they're much more understanding and sympathetic to it. Again, much like faculty, you need to clarify what the worth of what they're doing is. You also need to clarify that for students. So to me, open pedagogy offers many opportunities for students and faculty to contribute, and I don't think I'm being melodramatic here, to the greater sum of human knowledge. But if that lofty goal isn't enough, how about these two practical reasons? One, in this age of skepticism about the value of education, open pedagogy offers a direct counter to the notion of the closed-off ivory tower, to the question of what colleges and universities are doing and what we have to offer. And two, in this digital age, we should be teaching our students to create within and for a larger audience, using the tools of the medium to better prepare them for work, but also for their life after their time with us. Thank you.
Sure.
Next, we have Cheryl Huff. She's an associate professor of English and humanities at Germana Community College, you can set up, where she chairs the humanities department and coordinates a GCC Center for Excellence in Teaching and Learning. She enjoys the challenge of finding and using OER in creative course design. She received a VCCS Chancellor's Grant in the initial program to develop an OER English 112. It's interesting, everybody is an award winner, right? So I'm going to leave it to Cheryl.
Yes, hi. I came down from the ivory tower here.
It's not on. Turn it on.
It says on. Yeah.
Take a minute.
Yes.
Yeah. I teach at Germana. Diane actually had asked me for a bio like yesterday, and after one of those days, I was tearing around. So I was doing voice text into my email about my bio, and I said, Cheryl Huff teaches at Germana Community College, and I looked at the text, and it said, your mama, Community College. So I'm going to work on them to change the name of Germana, because nobody likes the name anyway. So change it to Your Mama, Community College. Which just pointed out one of the major problems of voice text, and I'm sure you're all familiar with it. I'm going to talk very anecdotally. I didn't bring a lot of data because I don't have a lot of data. I mean, I could go get a lot of data. I'd probably have to bother Preston and Richard. I think I bothered Richard and he ignored me because that was probably the right thing to do about data. But I feel very much about OER the way I felt about distance learning when I got in on it on kind of the ground floor. There were a lot of skeptics. There were a lot of hassles. There was a lot of anger on the part of faculty. You're going to make me do what? You're going to ruin my academic freedom. You're going to ruin my course. You're going to ruin my life. You're going to ruin my children's lives. and overcoming the hostility and the misconceptions and all of the baggage that came with implementing improvement in distance learning. I was part of our five-year QEP. I was a QEP coordinator, and our QEP was focused on improving distance learning. And I was very often considered the enemy when I taught the top class and gave someone a D because they hadn't even read the instructions. Or any of the initiatives that we did, we had to overcome a lot of problems and a lot of obstacles in terms of misconceptions and bad ideas. But we prevailed. And we worked very hard, and we did improve our distance learning program enormously. And we did create open avenues for faculty to keep giving us feedback on how they felt about this process. And I keep looking at OER in much the same way. I accidentally stumbled into OER. I was teaching an English 112 class, argument, rhetoric, some literary analysis, all the good stuff. And I was really bored with the textbook. And I kept hearing my colleagues say things like, they never do the reading. They never do the reading. And I thought, well, then why are you giving them so much reading? And I started bringing in TED Talks, and I started bringing in Annie Leonard's Story of Stuff. I started bringing in any kind of example of good rhetoric and argument, speeches, campaigns, advertising, anywhere where they could see argument in a way that wasn't just a reading in a textbook. So I eventually created this 112 class that I was only throwing in chapters of the textbook to justify them having had to buy the textbook. And if I got them early enough, I would say, return the book, return the book. And hope that the bookstore manager didn't hear me and no one told her. So when the Chancellor's Initiative, the first iteration came out, offering us a grant to design a course, the grant was for the top 15 most highest enrollment courses in the VCCS. I thought, well, I'm already doing it, so all I have to do is get the grant, and then I've got the class. Well, I got the grant and went down for 2 days to John Tyler and spent time with the Lumen people and Richard, and it just blew the top of my head off because I found out that there was so much more to what I knew than what I was doing. And so I became a believer and came back to the college. And this is kind of the process. So OER was underground. I was underground with my underground 112 doing OER, hoping no one would notice. There were other people doing it too, but I didn't know that for a little while. So when I came back from my mind-blowing experience with Lumen, I started talking to people, and people started talking to me. But we were all still being kind of furtive about the whole thing because there were a lot of myths and misconceptions about it. So it was very grassroots. So we all started passing things to each other and expanding on what we knew and sharing the information. But it wasn't until Richard came to a Germana faculty meeting and talked about OER. And he revealed the fact that I'd gotten a grant and I'd gotten $3,000. And they all turned around and looked at me in the auditorium. Why did Cheryl get $3,000? And then some of them attacked him about how he was ruining the textbook business and ruining the integrity of their classes. Yeah, two of the most embarrassing faculty went after him. But what actually happened after Richard left with the tomatoes on his and eggs on his shirt was that people came up to me and said, I really want to do this. They don't even have to give me the $3,000. And I said, well, there's going to be more. The chancellor did this first round. We're piloting. Here's what I have. Here's what I know. Here's what I got from Lumen. Here's some terrific stuff. I'm sure you have terrific stuff. And then the second round came out. So the grant money really turned on the planning at Germana and across in schools that I knew, people at other schools. It's just been said that giving credit to faculty legitimizes it. The money is a big part of it, and the recognition is a big part of it. But for some reason, our faculty saw money as a great motivator. So what we decided to do as an institution was to, it was two different ideas, apply for VCCS grants to bring in as much money to the college as we could, and also to create a system of rewarding our own faculty for doing the work. But also, it isn't just the money. It's you have to provide other forms of support. You have to get your librarians on board. You have to get your IT people on board. And no one had been doing this, so we decided to. My favorite expression, my favorite saying is that a camel is a horse designed by a committee. Picture a horse. So we did not want a committee. How many of you have 10,000 committees at your college? Yeah. How many of you feel like those committees make huge changes across the board, sweeping changes at your college? No. So what we're trying to do is avoid having a committee, but having a sort of underground group of people who are going after this. We're also intrinsically linked to the VCCS because the second iteration of Chancellor's Grants asked people to collaborate with other colleges, which is in the VCCS, which is phenomenal. And it's very much how we got distance learning to improve, was doing it, and we created a distance learning peer group. And what's being funded is creating materials that can be shared rather than individual courses. This is making our faculty feel like they have this big safety net. They're part of this group. They're one of the musketeers of the VCCS, and that their efforts are going to go beyond the walls of Germana and benefit other schools, benefit their friends at other colleges, give them a network, and they won't just be creating their own little group of OER materials on their own. So for us, it was not a matter of having any great administrative top-down initiative saying, okay, we're coming to you as faculty. We want you to create some OER resources. We want you to create an OER infrastructure. We want you to find the best possible way to teach using OER materials and go do that, which is the way a lot of people perceived what happened with distance learning. What happened was it came from the ground up. It came from the faculty who got interested in doing this and then recognized that it wasn't cheating to not use the textbook, that it wasn't cheating to design your course that was more relevant, more exciting, more engaging, more visual for your students, and then do that. So that's what we did. I wanted to end with, oh, the places you go if you just start somewhere. So I went looking for an image in Creative Commons for the book title, and I found this, and I realized what was wrong with this and why I should not be using this. It's because the picture has a Creative Commons license from someone's blog, but she's taken a picture of the cover of the book, which she does not have the rights to have. So I should not be showing you this. And these are the kinds of problems that people who want to do this, and to even be, before you even think about online pedagogy using OER resources, you have to understand what's going on. So beyond learning what happens in Creative Commons, this is legit Creative Commons, but it's not. So I wanted people to know that, and here's the Creative Commons license is the photo, but not the cover of that book, because they can't. So I wanted to point out that as an individual faculty member, the best thing that can happen to me is that I have support from my college, I have support from my colleagues, I have support from the system, and I have support from beyond our own system with the rest of the state, but then also with groups like Lumen, who I think of as like a great big beneficial organization for the world. Not too much pressure, Kim. So I'll welcome questions about pedagogy. I haven't really talked a whole lot about pedagogy in this because for me, OER pedagogy is as individual as each instructor that I know who uses it. But I have a pretty good idea of what my colleagues are doing, what the broader sense of what is happening across the VCCS. So I would welcome any questions about what we're doing to create positive OER initiative for our school. Thank you.
Next is Tom Woodward. And I did not need a bio from him because I knew him from the time he was a school teacher to Henrico's IT Autis, then the director of technology. But I had to know what he's doing right now, right? So I asked him, you know, give me a bio. And he says he works in VCU. His title reflects a focus on learning innovation, but he's still not sure what innovation really means. However, he's trying to do his best and interesting things with interesting people on a regular basis to discover about innovation. I don't know. So he's going to tell you what he's doing with the open pedagogy.
So I think a level of confusion is something that will likely to persist throughout this conversation, because a lot of this stuff I feel like I'm not really sure what people mean when they say certain words. Like I'm here under the label MOOC, right? So if I asked most of the people in here what that meant, we'd say the words, but the idea of massive, at what point does something go from being large to massive? Is it contextualized? If we have MOOCs with 200,000 students, is a 1,000 person class massive? I don't know. You know, it seems like a couple hundred students is pretty big, although I'm not sure it achieves massiveness in terms of this definition. So I may be talking more about something we did. If it reaches massiveness, I'll let you decide. And I'll kind of talk us through how we got here, because it's going to span content from a number of these different presentations. This is something we did this summer. It was called Thought Vectors. So what makes it a little bit unique in the scheme of MOOCs is that it was a freshman course, a required course for graduation. It was not the only required course option here, but it was kind of a thematic piece. So it's that freshman rhetoric composition, skill you up for the rest of college life type of course. A lot of writing intensive. And we ended up having, I think, 120 students involved, 6 different instructors, 6 different sections. So really small courses guided by people, but all brought together in this large communal environment all around publishing this stuff in the open. Now, there's a couple of open components to that, right? Students writing in the open, 6 different instructors collaborating to design a course and then enact it in the open once again, and reflecting on kind of the construction process, what they were thinking about, all the way building up to it. And if we go even farther back, this is based on stuff that's been going on at Mary Washington and other places for a while, this mother blog. So here, what you see is thoughtvectors.net, which is where all these sites come together in one place to kind of increase the incidences of serendipitous encounters between course levels, to build a sense of community, to provide a single access point in certain ways. And each one of the students have their own WordPress blog, or in some cases, other publishing platforms. That was another way in which we tried to make it open, is that if a student wanted to write in a particular environment and that environment had an RSS feed, that was okay with us. So we weren't constraining them to a very particular place or authoring tool. We were kind of opening up some choice for them. If they were a huge fan of Tumblr and that's what they liked and loved and had experience with, well, we can get a Tumblr feed and we can aggregate it here. You know, that's not a big deal. And once again, this is all based on conversations that have occurred in the open over time and space that I've participated in, that I've seen because other people like Jim and Martha and other people at UMW, you know, we've been having these conversations, VA specifically, for, I don't know, 6, 7, 8 years. It's been a long time. And then I like to see that this openness keeps bearing fruit. So those conversations and the technical stuff behind them and how to make all this work were done in the open. People could engage in it. And still, down the line, it keeps bearing fruit. So that's another piece of openness that I think is really important in terms of pedagogy, is talking about how you're teaching and how you're doing this stuff so that other people can see it. And even if they don't do it at the moment, that stuff can lay dormant for a long time, and then good things can come from it. So you can see here, you know, it's nothing fancy. It's a WordPress site, so open source software aggregating all this content. You see it rolling in still to some degree. You can see that there were nearly 3,000 total posts on almost 150 total blogs. So a lot of content in the end came here and is still here. That's another aspect of MOOCs and other online courses that I think it's worth talking about. When they're in the open, they are creating OER resources. So we interviewed people like Ted Nelson as part of this course, which was really cool. You know, to be able to talk to these early technology pioneers and shape that conversation in this particular way. But the videos of the Google Hangouts with Alan Kay and all these different, you know, which may not be tip of the tongue luminaries for tech people, but they are there. It's out there now. It's on YouTube. It's under a Creative Commons license. This content is now available for other people who want to participate. And I think that that kind of value can't be overstated, in addition to the value that's created by the students doing this work and then kind of mixing in with one another. You know, one of the things I did as we participated in this course was Indigo. I bookmarked when students would say beautiful things, right? You know, when I'd have those anecdotal little quotes that said something like, we had a VCU art student. You know, VCU's known for having one of the best art schools in the nation. She said, why doesn't VCU art talk to us about creating an online persona and portfolio in a more explicit way? This is so important. You know, so she's creating OER material for me to use as I engage with faculty in a variety of different ways as part of this course. So all these little bits of things and how I organize them and how I think about them, it's all done in the open, it's all contextualized, and I think it all matters quite a bit. Another element here which will undoubtedly bonk a little bit is an awesome guy in England made something to grab. Martin Hawksey, some of y'all may or may not be familiar with him, he made a really great thing that grabs tweets in a hashtag. Open source, using Google equipment here. Ours is going to hang a little bit because we have thousands of tweets. But it's another guy in England who happens to work for Open University created a tool which we then use in our course. So I guess what I'm trying to focus on here is kind of this virtuous circle of giving, both on the technology side and on the teaching side, and where those things intersect. Because that's one thing I think is really true and important, is that these things blend together. And it's hard to talk about them in isolation. Because if you don't understand what's possible, and you don't understand the capabilities of the tools, to think of the idea that you're going to use this to evaluate how people are using it, or even as a consideration piece, you know, it's much, much harder. But the way these things blend and the way they blend with our society becomes much more important. But I mean, it's kind of crazy to look at the density here of Twitter interactions. So not an open source material necessarily, but we've been able to capture all this stuff in a spreadsheet. We can do data analysis. One of the ladies I'm working with right now, Laura Guglia, is doing a whole piece of big data analytics on these interactions, as well as the connected course ones. So just another element that starts to blend things together. It's another example of people being open in terms of the products they're creating and our ability to then integrate them in open educational context. But at the core of all of it, was somebody deciding they didn't want to do all this in private, you know, that we could see it. And then it's been really powerful to see how the students have interacted. Some of them have gone on to do extra courses. We've been able to create different kinds of community, in part because of the publishing mechanisms as well. You can see how all these things break down. But the ability to create micro communities using metadata, right? So that's a fancy way of saying if you say you're in Ryan Cale's class, we can parse that data out and see just those posts. So we can have giant communities, but very easily and very quickly narrow down to these smaller communities to have different types of conversations. So I think that's important in that you can have the benefit of a large group, which is where we start to get into this massiveness, but you can have the intimacy and the friendships and the really intense smaller community interactions at the same time. So when you talk about kind of cake and eat it too, that's one of the important factors here for me. And in the same way, like, none of this is black and white. It doesn't have to be a choice between fully open and everything is entirely exposed or entirely locked down. It doesn't have to be a choice between only open source software and nothing, you know, private like Blackboard. It can be kind of this melding of these different things, because most of the fun stuff's going to happen in the gray. And to me, most of the life is kind of this grayish blur anyway. So being really intentional about the choices you make and not kind of coming off on this hardline zealot side of things where conversations don't occur, but being able to pitch and talk about the advantages of different things at different times has been a really important part of this type of pedagogy for us, and certainly for me. And that is my 10 minutes.
Next is Art Frederick, is the director of distance education at Virginia State University, a position he has held for 2 years. Prior to accepting this role, he had spent the prior 4 years serving as the director of strategic management services within the technology services department. These roles at VSU represent a small portion of his 37 years in higher education, either employed by the university or as a consultant to a university. Among the roles he has played within higher education are research associate, institutional research, Cleveland State University, assistant registrar. It goes on and on. So Art has served in several capacities as a member of EDUCAUSE, that's very important, and has participated in task forces for SHEV and the Association of Public and Land Grant Universities. And you have a PowerPoint, right? Okay, so after Art finishes, then I'm going to throw in a slide, then ask my first question, because I get the choice, right? And then it'll be open to all of you to ask questions.
Good afternoon, everybody. Has this been as spectacular for you as it's been for me? All right, we're there. So I was asked to talk about our LOOP program at Virginia State University. And I said, well, that's kind of interesting that I'd be at OpenVA talking about our LOOP program, which really is based all on proprietary things. But the common link between what we're discussing today in the open world and what we're doing at VSU is to try to increase the attainments of our students while also trying to reduce the cost associated with the delivery of the same. So in that, we share a commonality, but otherwise, this really is about linking together a bunch of proprietary things. And the reason why we started LOOPs at VSU is actually, conceptually, the provost was talking about our dilemma. And as everybody, we have a financial dilemma of one sort or another. And we have a lot of adjuncts, and we have a lot of unsuccessful students in our gatekeeper courses. That be some of our math, our English composition courses. It even goes over into history and some other areas. And we had to hire a lot of adjuncts to go and offer these second and third attempts at a course. And that just wasn't financially a reasonable model to go. So we started thinking about an online course where we could go and increase the enrollments of the classes to try to help these students step forward and make the grade during either the summer or the winter term. So that was part of the equation. Another part was a change in financial aid regulations, which during our summer and winter terms did not allow for the application of financial aid in most cases to taking courses. So our summer enrollments were starting to tank, and we needed to do something to try to keep our students moving forward. So this presented a great opportunity for us. What is a LOOP? I hope you enjoy my visuals. My wife wasn't too enamored with them. But first,
We started out as largely general education courses, and we started this program a year ago summer with four courses. They were biology, the intro to biology for non-majors, one history course, one math course, and one art course. So they all met GE requirements, and they actually all of them had less than stellar performances in terms of students successfully completing. We charged $199 for these courses, and that included all of their course materials. So that was really one of the reasons why we had to make the classes larger in size, was so that we could at least break even on them. And so we set our enrollments at 100 students. To date, we haven't had above 82 students enroll in one of the classes, and to date, we have not lost any money on any of our classes. And I'll talk a little bit about that in another slide or two. This summer, the growth of the program, last summer, the first time we had four courses and 325 students. This summer, we offered 10 courses. We had 430 students register. Last summer's enrollment represented 22% of the overall summer enrollment. This summer's represented 33% of the overall summer enrollment for the institution. And looking at, anybody get the little link I have over here on the right? Anybody old enough and David Byrne and how did I get here? We did have our students come from across the country. And when you think about the cost of courses, so you go and you say, well, at Virginia State, to take an undergraduate course is probably about $1,000. A little bit more, give or take. Then you have the textbook. Then, if it's a residence, you have to pay for your dorm or some other living, plus all of the other expenses that are associated with it. So by moving it online, you could be anywhere. And so we had students down in the Virgin Islands, all the way through California, not much in the middle ground, and really up and down the Eastern Corridor, which is really our strong suit student-wise anyhow. So. Again, we saw a 39% increase over the last year of all online classes, 507 for the summer. We're actually going to do our first winter term this year, and we have 9 LUC courses that are going to be offered this winter term for a 5-week period. One of the great things about the LUC, though, is it's kind of been our seed for a lot of other things. And so one is pre-assessment. So any student taking an online class, and we started with the LUCs and we've kind of spread this out, needs to take an online assessment. And it provides them feedback. Has anybody heard of Smarter Measure? So we're using Smarter Measure, and every student's required to go and complete that before they take an online class. And it's actually served some purpose in that we've seen, and I'm presuming it's because of this, some students drop out before classes start after they've taken the assessment. So they realize that they're not prepared to go and work in an online environment. So that's one thing that we've created out of it. The second thing we did was a fee-based digital course materials. So as I said, we included all of our course materials within that. Well, to go and set a foundation for that, about 2 years ago, we issued an RFP to invite vendors to go and respond back to how much they would charge us for digital course materials. Anybody familiar with Indiana University's project of the same? So we're not Indiana University. but we tried it on a smaller scale. And so we did get a few vendors back. And the result of that is that we're able to offer to our students their course materials at between 40 and 60% of the cost of the traditional going into the bookstore and buying their materials. So it's helping reduce the cost, and as a result, it's expanded beyond the LUC. So we take applications from the faculty and the departments to submit that all of their course sections for a particular course are going to use a certain set of resources. Then we go out to the vendor and we ask them for a quote back, and we get a quote back, and that's what we offer. Then we add a little administration fee, and because I'm the only one that's processing all of this stuff, so I have to pay myself somehow. And so we add a little admin fee, and that's what we put in the tuition. Last year, we had a little pushback in terms of the students, in terms of e-books and all of that stuff. This year, we really didn't see any in our evaluation feedback, so that's been a good sign. And what it's resulted in is that this fall, we offered 76 sections of courses using the fee content, involving 2,100 registrations or something along those lines. And so you do the metrics on that in terms of what that ends up dollar-wise, but it's absolutely significant. And what more importantly, probably from our standpoint, is now we know the kids have the resources. Whether they use them or not, yeah, that's another question. But if you look at national surveys, they say 35% of the students are buying their course materials, their textbooks and that, physical. This way, we know they absolutely have them. So there's no reason for them not being able to proceed through the course successfully. Thirdly, we started last summer an adaptive learning project with our biology program, and we're starting our second year. I wished I could say that the outcomes have been as successful as we hoped, but what we have done is dramatically changed a lot of the biology courses and the way that they're dealt with in terms of working with the students. So there's a lot more flipped classroom, there's a lot more interaction, there's mandatory meetings with counselors to go and look at their adaptive learning results and find out the weaknesses in that. So absolutely spectacular in terms of that. And we're getting into metrics as well. So we're looking at analytics, we're collecting information from Smarter Measure, from Blackboard, and other places, a student information system, to be able to go and look at what's happening. Unfortunately, or fortunately, it just gives us more work to do. When we look at the outcomes of the students, we were hoping to get the worst performing students to progress better through classes. But as we look through the results last year, and we haven't finished this year's yet, the outcomes for the LU courses were pretty much along their standard face-to-face class. So if they had a 3.0 and a face-to-face, they were getting about a 3.0 in the online environment as well. And it went that way down the board. And if you look at our overall GPAs in our courses, and so we took the last 2 years, in some cases 4 years, of history in courses to go and see what the GPA was for that class, and then compare it against the LUCs. Last summer, out of the four classes, two were higher, two were lower. This summer, it was four were higher, four were lower, one was the same, and one we don't have the information on yet. So. The end result is we still have a lot of work to do, and fortunately this process has allowed us to collect information. Our institutional research people say this has never been done before. So we're looking at data in different ways to be able to go and see how we move forward with successfully progressing our students through the graduation. And I don't know if I spent all my time, but it sure feels like it, so I will leave it at that point. And if you'd like to link in with me or Twitter with me, I have two Twitter accounts. The At Higher Vision really deals with higher education in general. The DE at VSU really deals with distance education. And I hope that if you're interested in anything we're doing, that you'll feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Okay. Before, if I can manipulate this, I don't even know where the mouse is. Can you all see that?
Yeah.
Okay. No. I didn't succeed.
I have a burning question. I know some of the two people talked about getting other faculty to be involved in open pedagogy or open education resources. We may have to give them incentives. It could be monetary incentives. And Jeff was talking about getting recognition. However, for this panel, you know, I read a lot about open pedagogy, right? Because everyone talks about OER. And it's very easy to convince K-12 teachers to embrace innovative technology integration practices as opposed to convincing four-year institution. I can't talk about two-year institutions because I've never worked in one of them, but I know four-year institutions, and it's very hard to motivate them. So even in the first panel, my burning question was related to faculty motivation. How are we getting that done? So when I was looking at open pedagogy, and the only person who has summarized everything is Knoll, because you know there are a lot of people, including David Wiley. But I kind of felt both Jeff as well as Cindy addressed these eight components when they talked about what is it that an open pedagogy looks like. And innovation, in addition to innovation and creativity, participatory connectedness. So I just wanted to know, what percentage of faculty in your institutions have really embraced this concept? And if it has not happened to even at least 30% or something, what can we do as Open Virginia community to motivate faculty members? What strategies might you suggest? All right, I think you all have a microphone, or, and when they finish, you all have the chance to ask your questions so you can think about your questions.
Who wants to go first?
Go ahead.
No, good. Thanks. Okay.
You ask.
Martha, where's Martha? How many Domain of One's Own faculty members do we have? Do you have a sense? Right. Okay. So that's roughly 20% of our faculty who have at least probably got their own domain names and established have played around with a hosting account, and then I think there are also people who haven't gone that route but have taken other routes to engage in open pedagogy. But 30% is probably a pretty safe number. I'd already said that I think it has to be recognized in the tenure and promotion process. People have to see models. I think over and over again the answer is models. They have to see people having done this already, and we have a critical mass of examples to show them at this point. And so I think I think seeing people who have done this successfully, seeing students who have done this successfully, seeing examples of curriculum in which we integrate these approaches and skills. There's plenty of examples out there. So providing those to faculty and giving them an incentive to do so, whether it's monetary or whether monetary works, whether it's monetary, whether it's recognition, or whether it's part of the tenure and promotion process, or whether it's something that is that comes from the top down. We happen to be at a place at Mary Washington right now where we have a president and a provost who very much understand and value this kind of work and have encouraged it in ways both in terms of the words that they say in public and in terms of the targeted investments they've made, even in a time of budget issues. So that helps. But I think people who are doing these things successfully, especially if you can get people who are hubs, people who are respected, people who are seen as particularly interested and well known within a given community, whatever that community is, whether it's the institutional community or a disciplinary community, and you have them present and talk about these things, if you can get that sort of transformational person or a group of people, then you can see a kind of spin-off to that. We've certainly seen that at Mary Washington, where students, where faculty have sort of seen people that they respect doing these things, and then they come in and say, "Well, we want to do that too." There also needs to be, though, some flexibility within curricular and programmatic structures that allow for this. Some programs are so rigidly defined that there isn't room for this kind of experimentation, and there isn't room for trying some of these things. And so working that in, and it may be as simple as adding something about digital literacy or digital fluency or use of open educational resources into overarching goals for the institution that then people can use to justify adding those things. But there are plenty of people who I talk to about this stuff, and they say, well, we can't change our curriculum. It's too structured. There's no room to do this. We have to cover all of these things, right? So the first step in some cases may be finding a little wiggle room in curricular and programmatic endeavors. I got lots more to say, but there are lots of very smart people on this panel. I'm going to turn it over to them. So.
I would say that less than 10% of our faculty have been actively involved in OER, but I would say another 10% were underground OER developers. And I would that this will probably, it will probably double in this year. And I think it will go a lot faster next year. It seemed to just need to hit a place. The budget cuts, we've resolved some issues, some mythology about the bookstore and what our relationship is with our campus bookstore. We've resolved some of that mythology. And now it's starting to leap. Some departments, as Jeff said, are resistant. I know our English department is very resistant, despite the fact that I designed a 112.
I would think that would be the one.
I know. And I think eventually it'll change. But I chair humanities, so it's history, religion, music, philosophy. We only have a couple full-time people. And what happens is I can only offer so many philosophy classes if I can find someone to teach them. And sometimes it has to be me. And if you're giving someone a class 2 weeks before it starts, if they have OER resources, they can run with it really well. And I did that. And then when I finally found someone to teach philosophy the next semester, I said, here's what I got. You want a book? And he said, no. And this is happening with humanities. It's happening with history. So people are getting on board a lot faster than I thought would happen, which is exciting. We have about 12 people who got very small grants to design materials just from Germana. So we got a little bit of money from the administration and said, this is what we want to do, and we're doing it. We did the same thing with designing distance learning courses like 6 years ago. We gave little grants to people to design an online course when we needed them, and we're doing this again, and it works. It's not much money, but it's an incentive and a recognition, and I agree, it has to be part of the evaluation process. We don't have tenure in the community college system, but we do have like tenure, so it's important.
I'll be brief in my one. I don't know what K-12 people Mono is working with. I found it to be a difficult conversation there as well. But anytime you try and change somebody's philosophy about teaching and then add technology into it, that's fairly adventurous, right? So I've been at VCU almost a year now. There are lots of people at VCU spread over a decent amount of space. So I'm not going to try and guess on percentages. And if I did, I don't. Because anytime I look at scale and start to think like that, I'm depressed. I get sad. I try and focus on the people who are moving stuff. I try and focus on people who want to do things. I do not try and move immovable objects. If certain people don't want to do things, that's the surest way to drive yourself mad and to end up with a product where they'll turn around and say, see, I told you I shouldn't have done that, as I self-sabotage myself. And so I've got no interest in any of that stuff. But we have gone from roughly zero blogs on our hosting stuff to almost 3,000, you know, in just this one semester. So, I mean, things can happen at scale fairly quickly when you have good leadership, you have people practicing what they preach. I happen to be lucky enough to work with Gardner Campbell, who was out here leading on this MOOC. He's the vice provost, and he's been able to get some traction in some certain ways that have been really advantageous for us.
I think I can be brief as well. About a year, 2 years ago, somewhere in that time frame, we had tried to join a consortium that was going to develop OER resources. Unfortunately, They went after foundation funding, and we didn't get it. So we have exactly what I would consider one open course on campus, and the only reason that that particular course is open is we paid for the person to do it last summer. And any future initiatives of that sort would likely involve the same. They says, yeah, I'd be willing to do another one if you paid me to do it. So that's the battle, the hurdle we have to overcome in some instances. I don't know that that's universal. I can't truly say, other than trying to press the initiative, the consortium. I haven't really pushed open resource. I do talk about it. I think it's a great idea. I'm one person, and there's not a lot of time to talk about all the subjects I need to.
If you do, raise your hand, I'll come.
Behind her. You know you had one.
I liked a lot of what Cheryl said. I just thought it was very interesting at the grassroots effort. But I want to know, your grassroots effort, how did you get your administration on board? Or did they push you, or did it come from the instructors up or the faculty down? Or sideways, and are you getting the support that you need from, I'm particularly thinking.
We're starting to, I would say. I think that once it became clear that the chancellor was making this a huge priority for the whole VCCS, then the president looked up, and then the vice president looked at the president, and then suddenly we could have a meeting saying, we need some money, we need some support, we need you to, here's some things we need, and it came from there. But it really came from the bottom up to the administration. They were kind of coming in on it a little bit later, but now.
So you started. Faculty just were underground doing things.
People were doing things in their courses. People were feeling very discontent about having book publishers dominate the
right
content. You know, it's you grow resentful sometimes that and popping out new editions all the time that you've got to make the students buy, and then you've got to readjust, especially if you teach an online class, you've got to readjust all your content because they move one chapter over here and another chapter over here, you know. So people were doing it, and people who had to teach classes at the last minute, that's a reality of community colleges. We add classes all the time in the week, you know, the last week of registration. We had things constantly change, and so having those resources under your belt was a good feeling for a lot of faculty, and so it was going on well before the administration saw it as a priority.
And your analogy of the adoption rate of a distance learning to this just rang with me. I understand exactly that piece of it. And I don't know if I have another 10 years in me. It took 10 years
right,
to get
exactly
get people to think that it was doable.
I say the same thing.
Oh,
yeah.
My gosh. All right, thank you.
Can I just add on to that? I mean, I think, so we heard one narrative in the last session about where Mary Washington stuff came from. There's also some other stuff that happened. So I was chair of the history department, and I didn't like any of the stuff that was happening with the web and the things we were able to use. So I just went and used my own department money to purchase a domain name and a hosting solution, and we just started putting up stuff on our own. And then when we had a bunch of stuff, I wrote this piece for the Chronicle, which talked about running a guerrilla departmental site. And all of a sudden, all the administrators came to me and said, wow, so you just did this on your own? Do you think other departments could do this? Well, yeah. I think that there are these moments where we have to, where that grassroots has sometimes goes around existing systems. And so one version of that story is you have to be really subversive. The other version of that story is pilots are really useful, and that when you develop a pilot and you begin to show, and now I think I would have gone to them and said, look, we're in this pilot, we've got the money, it's not going to affect any of the other systems on campus, let us try this, and we're going to go forward through this. It's not going to cost us very much money. It was a $150 experiment, right? You know, we're going to try this, and let's see what happens, and then come back to them. That's how I would do it now. The value of working examples are incredibly powerful.
Tom, I just wanted to make a comment. You had concerned about the slow conversion from the traditional textbook to using OER, electronic text, et cetera. I retired in 2011 from one of the community colleges in Florida, and in about 2009, Mother's Day, we started our process of converting from hardback text to electronic text, OER, digital born content, anything, because our students couldn't afford books anymore, just like yours. And when I retired, I started lecturing colleges and universities, and in my early lectures, I was talking about there won't be a hardback text in 10 years, and a majority of books will be replaced by OER in 10 years. And everybody laughed at me. 3 weeks ago, Bill Gates said 5 years. 3 months ago, the CEO of McGraw-Hill said 3 years. So have heart.
Richard has.
So I think this, first, I think coming from the perspective of the VCCS, and it's kind of getting to your point about scale, and that depresses you. Well, that's living my world, man. Because that's what I think about is scale, right? You know, but what's really encouraging at the community college system is I'm one guy, right? So we started with a couple of initiatives, but and the example of Germana is really good because I really did, it was the most beat up I've ever gotten when talking to faculty. I try to go around to all the colleges and say. And really, it was like, hey, here's how we are. You know, here's what it is. Here's what you can do with it. What do you think about that? And you would think I would say, I'm gonna set you on fire, and I'm going to, you know, steal your children. I mean, it was like a revolt, and people were standing up and yelling at me. And I was like, what did I say? Did I say something I didn't know I said? But I loved what came out of it. And I would offer to do that at every single, get beat up at every single college if there was a sub-revolt of faculty who said, hell, we're going to do this anyway. On our own, you know, and that's what's kind of happening, which is really encouraging because we talk about faculty incentives, we talk about, you know, and I'm not in disagreement with that, but faculty understand that the cost of text box is impacting their, they're not being successful and they're not getting, I mean, they care about the students, they want the students to succeed, and what they're seeing is that's not happening because the textbook costs $200. And they're taking matters into their own hands. And the administration, because of the chancellor, the administrations of these colleges really see, you know, starting to see the light. So for me, what's really encouraging is I get stopped by people saying, like Ruth, like, hey, you know, how do we get this OER stuff going at our college? It's not, you know, they're not fighting it back. They're trying to figure a way into it. But the question about open pedagogy, which I see is a little different, I think is really, I mean, I don't know, it seems to me a bigger step. And that's a real challenge that I would really like to have some at least some insight about. Because I think that's a really, I mean, it's one thing to adopt kind of materials and content, right? It's another thing to really fully embrace these tools so that you're out there exposed. You might, you know, some mm-hmm. faculty might see it that way, kind of exposed and out there practicing, teaching openly for the most part, which is a huge, huge step, but I think is the natural result of all this, right? It's sharing, because, you know, it's, you know, your job as a faculty member isn't just content delivery, right? It's content, but it's also how are you interacting with that content? What kind of things are you doing? Which I think is really valuable for others to see and practice and share. And so I guess I'm wondering, are there institutions out there where this has really been, I mean, it seems like Mary Washington is happening, other institutions where this has really become a cultural thing and how they got there, especially maybe larger institutions. Anyone?
Well, hello there.
really need to be out on the forefront of some other issues, right? Because it's certainly easy to envision, right, a faculty chair of a department at a college that has a gen ed course that maybe fills 20 sections. And instead of having three or four established, full-time, just teaching faculty, what do they have? They've got 10 or 12 adjuncts. And where is the solution to, I need to have some consistency, some proof of consistency across those gen ed courses, and invariably they're going to fall back on the textbook publishers, aren't they? I mean, that seems to be where we're at with that part of the dynamic.
I think that's the easy path, and having been a department chair, not that I always took the easy path, but certainly there are enough paths that I have to go down that some of them need to be easy. I think that we can also envision an alternate version in which an openly taught version of that class would be one in which what's happening in each of those classes is actually obvious to the department chair and is obvious to others as well, and that you can have a few people who are monitoring is not the right word, but are sort of leading that team of adjuncts in conversations about what's happening in those classes. And it's possible in the open environment, which it is not possible to do that in the traditional face-to-face closed classroom, to know what's happening on a day-to-day basis. But in an open environment, you do have a sense of what's going on, and you can see the products that are coming out of that. And it doesn't require reading 10,000 blog posts. It requires sort of dipping in and seeing the direction of things and getting a sense of where things are. So I actually think there's an alternative model which says it's not the textbook that should be the centralizing aspect. It's the open experience that can allow for both some variation, but also making sure that the ultimate set of learning objectives is being met. So that'd be my take.
And I think that's actually a really good place to end this session, because we're over time, because time moves fast when you're talking about open. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
For your time. We'll have about a 10-minute break, and then we will reconvene.